He's right, you know. This video is postlude number 3 to our 2019 documentary, Cosmic Disaster. The tune stays the same, and more scientists are racing to get in the door. This is advanced catastrophism at its truest, and that means it cannot be your first rodeo in this arena. Below the video and most of our videos, you can find a link to the Disaster Series playlist, all about the 12,000-year catastrophe cycle. If you have not done the preparation, this video will mean very little, like skipping the first 2 months of class and then showing up on a Tuesday. Hopefully, this includes at least the first 7 videos, but in a pinch, just the 7th, the initial documentary, Cosmic Disaster, is a great place to start. The first postlude is the very next video, Earth Disaster, A Science Revolution. And then, if you are short on time, you can absolutely skip all the way down to the disaster cycle marching on and the special message to you. That was postlude number 2. For those of you who have done the homework and are ready for the demonstration of the continuation of the rebirth of catastrophism, it begins now. The expansion of the nova category in progenitors and triggers continues, including the nova-like variables and those that seem to jump around between the categories. This is, of course, imperative to the bigger picture of the more widespread understanding of the variety and range of nova events, triggers, and progenitors. We continue to see more identification of the processes of ozone destruction. This is expected as an ongoing effect of our weakening magnetic field and is now seen in the only positive ozone trend being at the South Pole, where those chemicals had previously accumulated. And that analysis didn't include the record low ozone levels in 2020. Were dropping worldwide. We also saw how the drops in ozone can hide in some data sets and not in others, which is where pretty much all of those opposing statement papers are coming from. We follow up the previously reported weird animal behavior with the orca attacks. No, it's not unheard of, but they are acting out in incredible numbers and in as unfamiliar waters as those sharks and whales and racing pigeons. We also continued to see the ongoing geomagnetic biology topic advance from that navigation and other aspects of magnetoreception to even the negative effects of inclement space weather and geomagnetic minimum during secular variation, like the magnetic excursion we're heading towards now. The continued identification of polar summer mesospheric echo signatures brings back the big story that thermosphere temperatures are wholly driven by the sun and geomagnetism. Way up there in the sky, it's not CO2 as was previously believed. There's no signature of it at all. And so their explanation of CO2 for those mesosphere changes takes another hit. The explanation that it's the Earth's weakening magnetic field is strengthened. When you continue to get confirmations of the natural forcing down to the stratosphere, the explanation that it's Earth's weakening magnetic field working those layers above, again, is strengthened. Then things get very interesting as the Heinrich events, already tied to the 6,000-year solar cycle, now are also tied to the tropical hydroclimate events, as well as those cold outbreaks at mid and high latitude. Speaking of which, a super green, greenest of the green Sahara is what existed at the last half cycle, 6,000 years ago. The NOAA event, which needed more evidence, got more in the volcanic realm, almost right on the nose. And in the isotope record, where this might be the best example of it, as the impact on deposition dwarfs what we saw even at the full 12,000-year cycle event, the Younger Dryas and Gothenburg magnetic excursion. Speaking of which, the volcanic evidence from the last event got strengthened as well. We add Texas sediment evidence to that in Europe of the German Eiffel volcanic complex during the Younger Dryas. And when it comes to the LLSVPs, the Earth's internal skeleton, we got a non-flashy but critically important aspect of their character confirmed as recycling crustal material is found near the edges of the LLSVPs, but they themselves are not subducted crust. They are, in fact, core mantle boundary protrusions. These and the low velocity zones are critically important aspects of the disaster disruption in terms of the geophysical insult. And when it comes to mantle heaving, earth tilting, and the waters below, the evidence for unthinkable reservoirs beneath our feet rang out once again. We're standing on more water than you can envision. A lot more. Of the few Earth's rotation glitch stories, this was my favorite of the last 75 days. And for those who don't know, it is already mainstream science that many of Earth's length of day glitches, our rotation hiccups, are tied to solar storms, geomagnetic jerks, and longer solar cycles. This just happens to be a half harmonic of the sun's 3,000-year flare cycle. Speaking of geomagnetic jerks, the latest one was a global event. This compared to the 2017 event concentrated in the Pacific sector. It's not just the upper atmosphere having anomalies we can easily tie to the changing magnetic field, but the field itself continues to show new tricks. And speaking of new tricks, how about this one? Yes, it's just the baby step for the white dwarfs. Why they don't extend it further when they know solar flares produce elements? Every known element was detected in the solar wind by the JPL Genesis mission in the 90s, and the ongoing studies in this field are exceptionally detailed. Recall from previous updates that we know the sun's helium content is changing, and recall the number of coronal rain stories we had this week, how the falling condensate triggers eruptions, how it is triggered by a disruption at the upper corona, where the magnetic fields of the sun responsible for the helium change are also known to be changing. And this process represents the second way to get the solar micronova shell built up. We've now got two options under the disruption from the galactic magnetic reversal, and that shell, while heated in the micronova to nuclear-relevant temperatures, is in fact released via deflagration. As we continued to see discovered in space, deflagration of the accumulated shell. Of course, we've seen the other planets continue their destabilizations. Mars' seismicity increased in magnitude again, and the biggest one lasted 90 minutes. Jupiter's great red spot is tightening, and the wind is speeding up like a ballerina pulling arms in to spin more quickly. And we got confirmation about Pluto. It did lose a fifth, 20% of its atmosphere, in no more than 2 years, 2016 to 2018. The galactic sheet forcing this solar system shift continued to be flushed out mathematically in the models, but still showing too broad a region between galactic magnetic reversals. We did get some big confirmations of unmixed gases and waves of high-density clouds tens of parsecs apart. That should sound familiar. That's how I describe the gunk stuck to the electrostatic current sheet. We got a critical scalability confirmation about flux interactions from the heliopause out into galactic space, and it works exactly how the Earth-Sun magnetic connection works at the polar cusps as well. We'd hear the same in the abstract for a talk coming next month, confirming the current sheet and Parker instability-like nature of the rippling galactic field is indeed not just observable, but workable into the models. All you need is nova-level energy along the way. You heard correctly. Now, they used supernova in the paper as an example, but mathematically, if the current sheet triggers superflares and micronova and dwarf nova along the way, you get the same, if not more, energy. And so let me go ahead and simplify what I just said for you. We have shown a lot of the evidence already. They know from the polarization, dust density, gamma signatures, and more that the galactic current sheet ripples every few tens of light years, bringing the galactic magnetic reversal. But they have never been able to quite make the observations fit into their models or the theory. Now, what it finally took to bring those models and theory up to the observations of the current sheet was nova-level energy along the way. You've got to be kidding me. After all this, the galactic magnetic triggering of the solar micronova and similar events throughout the galaxy is what it takes to complete the picture. Not on board yet? Let's add to everything we know about the Earth's rotation and the Sun, and add in the fact that it's the thermosphere super rotation, its faster rotation than the ground below, being due to energy from above and geomagnetism. This, of course, must be true if all those other connections we've implied down to the core are true as well. Last but not least, folks, I think they finally spotted the dust. Their asteroid explanation is not a good one, and basically they've just realized there is more dust in the solar system than there should be. And if that's not the prediction of the last 3 years come true, I'm really not sure what is. Presuming you have done the homework we talked about, I imagine right now it's a little shocking to see everything that's happened in just the last 75 days since postlude number 2. If you didn't do the homework, you probably didn't make it this far. I'll see you in the morning for the daily update. Be safe, everyone.